Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and it is a very great pleasure to see you and such a privilege to have the opportunity of talking about a favorite piece of mine, namely the Magnificat by Alan Hovhaness. Now, I shall try to share my screen, including sound. Okay, here we are. So the piece I should like to talk about is the Magnificat by the composer Alan Hovhaness. You can see his portrait, photograph below, but no less significantly, from a personal point of view, is the image on the right-hand side. And that's when the Charles University Orchestra and Chorus, joined by a fine quartet of soloists, and I were privileged to give what I thought was the Czech premiere of the piece on the 24th of April 2015. But more recently, I checked my records, and it appears that it was not just the Czech record, it was the European, sorry, not just the Czech premiere, but the European premiere of the piece. So that's a photograph from that occasion. And I shall talk about those circumstances a little for the benefit of those who don't know what was going on. Now, we need to ask two things. If we're going to talk about the Hovhaness Magnificat, it behoves me to say what a Magnificat is and who Hovhaness was. Let's start with Magnificat. It's a biblical song from the Gospel according to St. Luke. And when the Virgin Mary visited her cousin Elizabeth, who was expecting St. John the Baptist, both ladies were pregnant, St. Luke says that when Mary greeted Elizabeth, something happened in Elizabeth's womb. There was a movement. Her baby somehow acknowledged the presence of the as yet unknown Jesus. And at that point, Mary responded with the words of the Magnificat. So it's known as one of the canticles. These are hymns that are derived directly from Scripture. So there's a song of Moses when the Israelites managed to cross the Red Sea whilst the Egyptians' chariots were destroyed by the waves. They spontaneously started singing and giving thanks and praising God. So this is one of those canticles from the Bible, the Song of Mary. And in Latin, the text is Magnificat anima mea Dominum, and so on and so forth. The most widespread English version is that of the 1662 Book of Common Prayer, the words being, my soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Saviour. Now, note that for those of you who know a bit of Latin, the English text is not necessarily a perfectly exact translation of the Latin. So, suscepit Israel, or if you prefer the German style of pronunciation, suscepit Israel, puerum suum, the puerum has been translated as his servant instead of his child. But these are the received, the standard texts, and the doxology at the end, the Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto, glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Ghost, that bit has been added. It's not part of what you find in St. Luke's Gospel. Would you care to mute your microphones, ladies and gentlemen? You're probably not aware of it, but I can hear conversations. Okay, can you mute your microphones? Thank you very much. So this is the text. And if we summarize what's going on, the Virgin Mary, first of all, she rejoices that she is going to have the privilege of giving birth to the promised Messiah. She glorifies God, magnifies, as in Magnificat, means you acknowledge the greatness, or you make great someone with your praise. And she looks forward to the transformation of the world by God through the Messiah to whom she will give birth. And part of this transformation, and this is quite revolutionary actually, is that the proud will be brought low and those who are humble will be lifted up. The hungry will receive good things, but the rich will be sent away empty-handed. And then in the final section of the text, she exalts God who has kept his promise to Abraham, referring to the Old Testament, to the book of Genesis. And this text, which is not particularly long, has inspired very many generations of composers. And if you want to, you can probably find on Wikipedia something like a comprehensive list of composers with their Magnificat settings. But I've written here only a tiny proportion of all that. Would you like to switch off to mute your microphone? We can hear you. Okay. So what you can hear, what you can see here is just a small number of Magnificats compared to all the Magnificats that have been composed. First, if we look at the ones in Latin, Magnificat anima mea dominum, there are versions in Gregorian chant. Then the English composer Taverner has three. Then, proceeding chronologically, just after Taverner, there's Fairfax. He has two. I recommend one of them, which is known as the Magnificat Regale. Palestrina wrote no fewer than 35 settings, but that's nothing numerically compared to Orlando di Lasso, or Lassus, who composed over 100 distinct musical settings. Giovanni Gabrielli has written one. Monteverdi has four settings.
I think maybe you can mute the other participants if you are the host.
I am the host. I don't know how I may do so. It's not. I hope I may be getting nearer. Mute. Okay, perhaps we are all muted now. Okay, good. Okay, sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, so Orlando di Lasso wrote over 100. There's one by Giovanni Gabrielli. We have four by Monteverdi. They're all extremely good. We shall hear a little bit of one of them in a moment. Two of them are in a huge, magnificent collection of religious works called Selva Morale e Spirituale, and two of them are associated with the Vespers of 1610, the Vespers of the Blessed Virgin, about which I talked last semester, and you can find the video on YouTube if you want to see it again, or if you haven't seen it yet. Marc-Antoine Charpentier, whose famous Te Deum most of us have heard and some of us have performed, he wrote no fewer than 10 different settings. There's, I believe, one by Vivaldi. The Czech composer, the great Czech composer Zelenka, wrote three, but sadly one of them hasn't reached us. We've got two. There's one by Bach, to which we shall turn in a couple of moments. And then there are some rarely heard versions that I myself don't know, but believe it or not, Mozart, Schubert, Mendelssohn, Liszt, Bruckner all wrote Magnificat settings. There are various modern versions written in the 20th century, but the most recent is one I heard a couple of years ago And it's by my former professor at the at HAMU, at the Musical Academy, at the Academy of Performing Arts in Prague, Juraj Filas. I'll say a little bit about that as well. But before we look at those, let's also consider the English version, which is typically the words of the 1662 Book of Common Prayer, "My soul doth magnify the Lord." The very great English composers Tallis and Bird have their own versions, in English, of course, as I said. Orlando Gibbons, if I remember rightly, he has more than one. Adrian Batten, I think more than one, but there's one in particular that I have sung as well as conducted. Stanford, Ralph Vaughan Williams, Edmund Rabra, and many others have set those words, some of them more than a single version. And let us not forget the Russian tradition. A version that many of you might know is that by Rachmaninoff. It is part of his all-night vigil, but there are others as well. Let's continue. So, my own favorite, really early version, is found in a very rare and precious collection known as the Eton Choir Book. It is a manuscript that, unfortunately, it's not incomplete. Some of the works in it have not been preserved in their entirety. There are 93, most complete, but some incomplete. 26 composers are represented there. And it is known as the Eton Choir Book. It is kept at the Eton College Library. It's known as Manuscript 178. And it consists of works that were composed in the late 15th century. And the one that I particularly love is by Robert Fairfax, who was an English composer. You can see his dates above, 1464 to 1521. Now, I found it difficult to find a recording on YouTube that I liked, although there are several, but there has been an unfortunate tendency, difficult to justify musicologically, to transpose some of the pieces written by English composers of this period up a minor third. Some of these choirs are professional choirs, and they have extremely good, agile sopranos with high notes. And in a cathedral, you know, it sounds ethereal, as if angels are singing. But in fact, there are no musicological grounds for transposing upwards. And if you don't transpose and you sing at what we think is probably the original pitch, yes, okay, you don't get those ethereal sounds, but you get those rich, searching depths with the male voices. That also sound really great in a cathedral, in a Gothic building. And as a student in Cambridge, we had a professor, a lecturer called Dr. Roger Bowers, who conducted a lot of this music, and I was privileged to sing under his direction. And we made some recordings, we broadcast for the BBC, and we released an LP. You can tell how long ago it was. It was an LP, not a CD. You can find it on YouTube these days. And on the jacket of the LP, he wrote, "A curious fad seems recently to have arisen in certain quarters for transposing those pieces up a minor third." We didn't record the Magnificat. We recorded Aeterne Laudis Lilium by Fairfax. But now, to give you a little flavor of the earliest of my favorite versions of the Magnificat, I'll play you just a little bit so that you can see what sort of sound world it is that we're starting with.
Oh,
Ladies and gentlemen, this was also one of the very first pieces I conducted in, I think, either my first concert or one of my first concerts. Note how the setting starts from Et exultavit, because the first words are sung in unison as plain chant, Magnificat anima mea Dominum, and then the choir in several parts comes in. Now, next, my favorite version of the Magnificat that follows chronologically, all four of the Monteverdi Magnificats are really wonderful pieces, and we're lucky that we don't have to choose any one. But just for this evening, as a demonstration of the rather different sound world that we're entering when particularly we move to 17th century Italy, I'll choose the smaller of the two versions that go with the Monteverdi Vespers of 1610, the one for six voices. There's the other one is for seven voices and larger orchestra as well. I will be playing you just a little bit of a rehearsal of the work, conducted by Michel Corboz, who is a very fine Monteverdi interpreter, whom I greatly admire. Again, just a little sampler. We're working our way like this until we get to the Hovhaness Magnificat, to put it in context. Now, some of you may remember a good while ago, the Charles University Chorus and members of the Charles University Orchestra and I perform this very Monteverdi Magnificat in the Catholic Church of Nei Svetlici Salvator. But it was a good while ago, so I suspect that most of you had not yet joined the choir. Next, amongst my favorites, I have to include the Bach Magnificat. He wrote only one, as far as I know, but the well-known and well-loved Magnificat in D has a precursor. Originally, it was in E-flat, and later on, it was altered. On the right-hand side, you can see a page from Bach's autograph manuscript, and I think that it is, if I'm not mistaken, I can't see. No, it is in D. It is in D. I didn't manage to find the earlier version in E-flat. I suspect it exists. Anyway, but this also is something that our chorus and orchestra know. I will, again, play a little bit of the opening of it, so that you can all see how things have changed from Monteverdi, where we started, what sort of journey music has been following along the centuries until we reach Bach. Thank you. So, now, some of you may have memories. We performed this not that long ago. I think that I shall be able to show you a photograph of that event a little bit later in the presentation, because we shall have reason to return to Bach. But this introductory section, I should like to end by mentioning the most recent version, the most recently composed version of the Bach of the Magnificat, sorry, not by Bach, by my own professor Juraj Filas, with whom I was privileged to study stylistic composition at HAMU, the Prague Academy of Performing Arts. Professor Filas very kindly texted me to inform me that there would be the premiere of his setting of the Magnificat for orchestra and chorus at the Evangelical Svati Salvator, the second Svati Salvator, on the 2nd of July of 2018. And I had just returned from an overnight flight from Washington. I managed to get up, wake myself up with an alarm clock and get to the church. And it was a marvelous experience to hear the piece. Juraj Filas is a neo-romantic composer, if we had to attach a label to him. His Requiem setting, by the way, which received its Prague premiere something like 15 years ago, is a magnificent piece also. And it's extremely attractive music, very powerful music. Professor Filas, for many years, worked as a pianist coaching singers, and you can tell that he has a tremendous love and understanding for the human voice. And there were those most marvelous floating, soaring soprano solos, beautiful choral writing. I wrote this paragraph that you can see here on my Facebook page just after the performance, and this is a photograph from the event. I don't have a recording of it, but I'm sure that sooner or later one will become available if it isn't already. And I urge you to hear it, or indeed anything else written by Mr. Filas. He has some marvelous symphonies as well, and very high quality chamber music. But now let us turn to Alan Hovhaness. After all, we're going to talk about his Magnificat. But I just wanted to put it in context by giving you a little sample of some other settings, three before his own and one more recent than his own, although we weren't able to hear it. I don't know if you're able to see the entirety of my screen. He was born in 1911, he died in 2000, so not all that long ago. He is American, he was born in the United States. His father was Armenian, his mother came from a Scottish family, although also born in the United States. His father was a chemistry professor, and he had piano lessons and composition lessons. He showed early promise. Some of the influences in his writing, he became a very great friend of Sibelius, and they corresponded together for 20 years or so, and he even traveled to Finland to meet Sibelius, and he even named his daughter Jean Christian Sibelius, after Sibelius, and Sibelius was her godfather. And the friendship lasted until Sibelius passed away. Now, Hovhaness was also an admirer and interpreter of Archimandrite Komidas, and he accompanied some of Komidas's folk song arrangements, for which Komidas furnished piano accompaniments. There exists a very beautiful recording of a selection of those. He recorded Komidas's dances for the piano, and for a while he also harmonized Armenian hymns. Some of those I have, But I believe that most of what he has is unpublished, and it remains in the Charents Museum in Yerevan, where it deserves to be studied and possibly published and revived. There are also archives at Harvard University, at the University of Washington, and the Library of Congress of some of Hovhaness's papers and compositions. But in the 1930s and 1940s, he had a sort of crisis. He decided that what he had composed was not of a sufficient standard, not of a sufficiently high quality, and he burned some 1,000 early compositions. 1,000, that's a huge amount. A lot of composers don't compose as many as 1,000 works throughout their career, whereas he actually destroyed so many. And when in later life at various interviews he was asked why did he do it, he said things like, well, I moved into a smaller flat and I didn't have a lot of room and I got fed up. And apparently he had a fireplace, and for about a week he kept that fireplace burning by just feeding the fire with compositions that he no longer liked. Even so, we still have over 500 works by him, including almost 70 symphonies. Not all published, but I believe most are. Now, he won a scholarship to study at Tanglewood in Boston with Bohuslav Martinu. But he left early because he had a personal antagonism with Copland and Bernstein, Leonard Bernstein. So I don't know what happened with his lessons with Bohuslav Martinu. But as I said, he continued to correspond with Sibelius, and perhaps he received advice from Sibelius. And also other American composers such as Roger Sessions and John Cage, were appreciative of his music. For many years, he taught at the Boston Conservatory, and one of his great successes and what led to increased recognition is that the celebrated conductor Leopold Stokowski premiered his Symphony No. 2, subtitled Mysterious Mountain. And later on, another celebrated conductor, Fritz Reiner, with the magnificent Chicago Symphony Orchestra, they recorded the piece. You can see on the right upper right-hand side what the CD looks like. I'm not sure if it is the CD reissue or it's the original LP cover there. I shall just look at the chat comments in case someone tells me. Right, an interesting comment by Michaela. Who says, as we heard part of Monteverdi's Magnificat, I realized that this must have inspired a Slovak composer, Vladimir Godar, who wrote a Magnificat in the old Czech language with Iva Bitova singing some years ago. Thank you very much, Michaela, for this recommendation. And by the way, Juraj Filas, although he lives and works in the Czech Republic, he's also Slovak as well. Excellent. Increasingly, he gained recognition, and the Boston Globe wrote that the atmosphere of his music is hushed, reverential, mystical, nostalgic. This is true enough, but Alan Hovhaness can also get extremely loud with huge brass choirs and percussion of all sorts, particularly if you listen to his celebrated Mount St. Helen Symphony, which is number 50. Mount St. Helen is a volcano. And in his music, he represents the state at which this volcano erupts. And it's really very exciting. It's as exciting in a physical sort of way, the sheer volume of sound, as a rock concert, the huge sound and so on. It's really very powerful music in all sorts of ways, but including a physical way. Now, the Magnificat. I shall gradually approach our main target, so to speak. Officially, it's his opus 157, although, of course, as we saw, he wrote a lot of things that he destroyed which don't have an opus number. It was composed in 1958 And it was premiered on the 26th of January 1959, so it didn't have to wait for very long. And on the cover of my score, there are some, on the inner cover of my score, there are some reports from the comments made by critics who attended the premiere, and some of the things that Hovhaness himself said about what he was trying to do. And basically he said he was trying to capture what he saw as being the mysticism and mystery of early Christianity in his music. Now, soon after the premiere, already in 1961, a recording was released on LP, a recording that I'm very fond of and which, in my opinion, has not been improved upon, although there have been several recordings more recently. By this time, or shortly thereafter, Hovhaness moved to Switzerland. He had a flat in Lucerne. But the final years of his life, he spent back in the United States in Seattle, where he established a good working relationship with the Seattle Symphony Orchestra and Gerald Schwartz, their musical director. And they recorded some of his works as well. And they're still available to be had and to be enjoyed. Now, let us proceed to the next slide. Little bits of further information about him. First of all, there's a full-length documentary on Alan Hovhaness, including interviews with the composer where you can see him talk. You can see him sit in a cafe and compose. As you can tell from the huge amount of music he wrote, he was really prolific. And he enjoyed composing, and he would get up early in the morning and start compose. And he said that he enjoyed composing in coffee shops. He would go to a cafe and sit there and produce pages and pages of music. So you can find that documentary if you're interested. I strongly recommend also his orchestral piece Fra Angelico, which the Charles University Chorus has also performed, and that was a Czech premiere, although it had been performed in Europe before, in Germany, I think. And his Symphony No. 11, which has the subtitle All Men Shall Be Brothers. And the ending of that symphony is really very reminiscent of Sibelius as well. He conducted many of his own works with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra in London, and those recordings I particularly recommend. Because although he was not, I don't think he studied conducting, but he was very effective in conducting his own works with the orchestra. He could somehow communicate what he wanted, and they would give him what he wanted. And those are fabulous recordings. He also has a famous piece called And God Created Great Whales for taped whale songs and orchestra. And that had a famous recording with, I think, André Kostelanets and his orchestra in 1970. He did have an interest in the modality of Armenian sacred music, but also he expanded his horizons and he became very interested. And in fact, he spent a lot of time studying Indian music, Japanese music, and other Far Eastern traditions. He even learned to play the sitar himself and a variety of different instruments. He was, above all, though, a very creative and fluent contrapuntalist. So, in a sense, he continued Bach's tradition. He was extremely good at combining two, three, or more voices together in a wonderful sort of way. Another cultural influence was the Greek-American artist, I think he was a painter, Hermon Di Giovanno. Di Giovanno helped Hovhaness expand his horizons, and it was this friendship, apparently, that gave rise to Hovhaness's aleatoric music, music where there are random elements. He more or less started doing this in parallel with, at the same time, I don't know who did it first, but I don't think they were influenced by each other, they both arrived at this at the same time, with the Polish composer Witold Lutosławski. And this typically involved instructions in the score that particular instruments or even voices should repeat their phrase in an uncoordinated manner for a given amount of time, so that together they produce a complex cloud effect, or if you like, a certain carpet of sounds. When Hovhaness was preparing a grant application, and he successfully obtained various prestigious grants to go to the Far East and study various Oriental instruments and musics and to compose works, in his application he wrote, and you can see how ambitious this sounds, "I propose to create an heroic, monumental style of composition, simple enough to inspire all people, to inspire all mankind with new heroism and spiritual nobility." And he said, this may seem to be a very ambitious goal, but remember that Palestrina, Handel, and Beethoven would not consider it impossible. So Hovhaness, although he was a very down-to-earth sort of chap and a very modest man, nonetheless, he knew the worth of what he was doing. And the American writer Lou Harrison wrote, "It is very modern indeed in its elegant simplicity and adamant modal integrity," when writing about Hovhaness's music. And I would say that I wouldn't be surprised if it turns out that Alan Hovhaness is at the moment possibly one of the most popular composers of serious music in the world, because he has very many admirers in places like India and Japan with their large populations. If you have access to the Naxos Music Library as members of the Prague Municipal Library, you're entitled to such access. There are a lot of recordings on various labels, but even on the label Naxos itself, there are quite a few very fine recordings, including his Symphony No. 1, the Exile Symphony, Symphony No. 50, Mount St. Helens, that I mentioned, and various other works, including works for just strings or works only for brass instruments, chamber music, and so on and so forth. I don't want to spend too long quoting the things that he said, but there is a particularly long interview you can find on the web with Bruce Duffy, conducted in Seattle in 1985, he talks about conductors, and it's rather amusing because Bruce Duffy asked Alan Hovhaness, "Have you conducted a lot of your work?" And Hovhaness said, "Yes, I have done quite a lot. I like to do first performances." And why? Well, Hovhaness says that "I usually know my scores better than conductors do, so I can spot mistakes." But he didn't consider himself to be the ideal interpreter, and he acknowledged that other conductors could possibly interpret the music and make it work in ways that he didn't do. But he did comment that some conductors nowadays, he said, are not very well-trained musicians. "I know a lot more than they know about what's in the score. And very few people can judge a full orchestral score just by sight reading it." And Hovhaness said, any conductor who says that he doesn't need to have a tape when there is a recording of the piece, he's a fake, he's a fraud, because just by studying the score or playing it at the piano, you can never get a full grasp of it. And about religion, because after all, the Magnificat is a sacred text. It's a text from the Gospel according to St. Luke, as we said. What about his religious views? He said, "I'm religious in a way. I find good in all religions, so I'm just not trying to sell religion like an insurance man." And the other thing that is very interesting is that Hovhaness says on many occasions that he's a great admirer of Bach and especially of Handel. As some of you will know, last week we talked about Handel and particularly his piece, Alexander's Feast. And Hovhaness considered Handel's Messiah, as well as all of Handel's work, as some of the greatest music that's ever been written. He was also a tremendous admirer of Sibelius, and not just the symphonies. And in fact, people like Stravinsky, who had dismissed pieces like Finlandia by Sibelius as being perhaps too popular or intended immediately to please, Hovhaness took a different view, and even Finlandia, that had been criticized by Stravinsky, he considered Finlandia to be, in his own words, a damn good piece. And it was a popular piece, but it was written to defeat the Russians, and it worked. And the ancient Chinese did that as well, apparently. They used music. They had gagaku pieces to smite the enemy, and Finlandia was that kind of piece. So interesting thoughts by Allan Hovhaness about other composers, ranging all the way from Handel to Sibelius. Hovhaness also speaks very highly of more modern composers. But let us pass on, because we want to talk about Hovhaness's music today. Something about my own love of the Magnificat by Allan Hovhaness. I've known this piece from my childhood. As it happens, my primary school music teacher and a very dear family friend and a very fine man called Hairabet Torosyan, who passed away, unfortunately, at an early age some years ago, and he had given me as a present a score of the Messiah by Handel, from which I continue to conduct to this day. He also worked for the Cyprus Broadcasting Corporation, that is the state radio, and he would play and choose various recordings of classical music, serious music on the radio. And I think it was one Wednesday afternoon when I switched on the radio as a boy, and I heard this. So it was near the end of the piece, and then when the recording finished, it was the news, it was 4 o'clock, and it wasn't announced what the piece was. And I was crazy with it. I remembered the melody, but I didn't know what it was. Anyway, it didn't take long. Fortunately, the broadcaster on duty at the time was Mr. Torosyan. So he said, yes, it is the Allan Hovhaness Magnificat. And as he did, as his wife also did, so often when I heard something that I really desperately wanted, they would informally make a cassette recording of it for me and let me have the cassette. So I got a cassette recording of the Hovhaness Magnificat, and I would play it every day at a certain stage in my life. And as a student in Cambridge, in my first year as an undergraduate, I remember a very dear friend and fellow student, now a very well-known writer and music critic, Jessica Duchin, knocked on my door and came to my room and said, "What are you playing? This is beautiful. This is magnificent." It was the Allan Hovhaness Magnificat. And it took 40 years from when I first heard the piece on the radio in Cyprus, it took 40 years until I had the chance, maybe not 40, 35, I'm not sure, I haven't done the arithmetic, when I had the opportunity of conducting the piece, performing the piece myself, and not just anywhere, but in St. Vitus's Cathedral, which is a particularly magnificent place, both acoustically in terms of the beauty of the building, the feeling of sacredness, the atmosphere of it, and also the sense of being, you know, the very heart of Czech statehood. And after we performed it, actually we found out from the publishers that it was the Continental premiere, it was the European premiere of the piece. And because we didn't have enough money to hire, officially to hire vocal scores for every member of the chorus, our valiant choral singers learned the whole piece by heart. So the soloists, yes, they each had a score, but the members of the chorus, they sang it without the music. I myself, I can confess that I didn't know if it's going to work, if our members will be able to learn it by heart and perform it with me. But they did, and they did it extremely well. And moreover, not having any music in their hands that they could bury their heads in, they were watching me. So there was marvelous communication between the chorus and myself. And so despite the distance and despite the rather muddy acoustics of this huge, tall, Gothic space, the chorus was always with me. So that was really a treasurable and really magnificent experience. Now, I should try to move to the next slide. Now, let me say you something about the background, how it was achieved. A meeting was held. First of all, it was my suggestion to the Armenian embassy. Back in 2013, at that time, there's a bit of politics behind this that I should explain. We performed the piece on the 24th of April 2015 in St. Vitus's Cathedral. That was the plan that was realized. And at that time, the Czech Republic had not yet officially recognized the Armenian genocide. The 24th of April 2015 was exactly the 100th anniversary of the genocide. So I had the idea, and I asked to have a meeting with the ambassador's deputy and wife to make a suggestion, and she very kindly agreed to see me. And I said, look, given that the Czech Republic has not yet officially recognized the genocide, we cannot have a special event in Prague Castle because the state has not recognized it. But we can do something in St. Vitus's Cathedral because the Cardinal, Archbishop Duka, who does recognize the genocide, the Catholic Church did, he can allow us to have an event inside the cathedral, which is right into the heart of Prague Castle. So it would be a success from a political point of view, but musically we could perform the Hovhaness Magnificat. Now, the Magnificat is not a work of mourning. It's not funereal music, it is not sad music, but that is okay. In fact, that is what we need, because the church decided that that year they would declare the people who died during the genocide to be saints. And theologically, if the people who were killed are saints, then we should no longer mourn the saints, but we should give thanks for having those saints. So the Hovhaness Magnificat would be a marvelous way of marking the occasion in St. Vitus's Cathedral. And the idea was conveyed to His Excellency the Ambassador. He liked the idea, and a secret meeting was arranged with His Eminence the Cardinal, the very Reverend Parsekh Pilafjan, the Archimandrite of the Armenian community, His Excellency the Ambassador, and myself. And this meeting was kept a secret at the time because there was concern that there might be certain parties that will be against the event, against this sort of indirect way of giving official recognition to the event. So the meeting was held in strict secrecy, although a photograph was taken, which I'm now showing you on the occasion. And His Eminence, the Prague Archbishop, was very, very eager that this concert should happen. And before the concert, there was a religious service at which various leaders from various churches, various denominations, my dear friend Michal Forst from the Jewish community in Prague, were all present. And then we performed a program with the chorus and orchestra of Charles University and soloists. And if you want to see the complete concert, it is on YouTube. We started with Fra Angelico, which sounded really marvelous in the space of St. Vitus's Cathedral, and then the Magnificat. And then at the end, we finished with the Procession of the Sardar, number 4 of the 4 Caucasian sketches by Ippolito Ivanov. And that really roused the audience. And it was a most inspiring occasion. These are a couple of photographs from the occasion, and you see no one in the chorus is holding any music. They all sang by heart. So this brings back memories. A friend made a very brief, it's not even a minute, video on his mobile phone where you can see the roof of the cathedral and the echo as the chorus is singing and the orchestra is playing. I'll just give you a brief demonstration. I won't be playing the video of our performance because videos from YouTube don't tend to work very well on Zoom. But I'll let you hear this. So that's all there is. It's a few seconds, but you get a feeling of the space, what a magnificent experience it is to perform in that space. Something that the Charles University Orchestra and I had already done for Czech television for a program called Krajina Ticha, where we had performed excerpts from Beethoven's Symphony No. 9 in this same space some years previously. So it was not our first appearance in St. Vitus's Cathedral. Nor do I hope will it be our last. Now, recordings. My favorite recording of the Magnificat is in fact the first recording conducted by Robert Whitney, who was the founder of the Louisville Orchestra. And the chorus and the orchestra and the soloists sing beautifully. There have been several more recent versions, but I have found them to be rather disappointing, I'm afraid. In that even when the performance is technically okay, they miss the musical point. It doesn't work so well. I think that Robert Whitney had a special understanding of the score, a special feeling for this music. Particularly disappointing is a video of the Armenian Philharmonic Orchestra and the Academic Chorus on YouTube, which musically is indifferent, and even the brass instruments come in the wrong place at one point. It's rather an undisciplined orchestra, as I discovered when I conducted it myself in 2003. I hope that one day they do it again and they do it better, because the piece deserves it. But for the moment, the Whitney recording is the one that I recommend and the one that gives me consistent pleasure. And this is what the original sleeve of it looked like when it was released in 1960, I think we said, or thereabouts. Now, let's start looking at the piece itself. You can see the text in two columns on the left-hand side of the Magnificat, and every time there's bold, so Magnificat et exultavit, quia respectit, and then within the same sentence, omnes generationes, and so on and so forth, that is a new movement in the Hovhaness setting. And there's this prelude, this sort of celestial fanfare, as it is known. So this is how it is divided into different movements, and it lasts about half an hour. Now, if we look at the first movement, I shall omit the introduction, the celestial fanfare, if I may. You can see how the music works. This is from the score, the vocal score, the accompaniment, the piano reduction. The strings are playing this the moment when the chorus has come in. And they are singing, Magnificat anima mea dominum. And it's moving in parallel triads. Di-da, di-da, it's ya-da-da, di-da-di, do-da-da, do-do-dum. Di-di-di, ya-da-da, di-di-di, di-di-di, da-da-di, di-di-di, di-di-di, do-do-dum. So you're getting those triads that are moving in parallel, but also you're getting these so-called false relations. So you hear an A natural, and then you hear an A flat. You hear an F, and then, so the A natural is here, and then A flat. And then you hear an F natural, and then an F sharp. And this gives it this slightly mystical, oriental feel. Now, there's another thing about the modality of it. So if you think of this as being a sort of F major, instead of there's E flat as we're going up instead of E natural. And this also gives it an Eastern modality. You find this in Byzantine music, and you find this in Armenian church music as well. Those of you who know, and I know many of you have played the Sahagyan Skomitas suite, based on the Armenian liturgy. Instead of So let me play you a little bit of this. The first movement after the overture, the prelude, the celestial fanfare, the Magnificat itself. Thank you. By the way, you will have noticed that there was a fugal passage there as well. And again, Hovhaness delights in writing little fugues or fugato passages, or generally using counterpoint in a very expressive and natural sort of way. He had a special gift for counterpoint, and no wonder he was a great admirer of Bach. Let's continue. This is a passage that members of the Charles University Chorus will know. It is from one of the movements of the Comitas Sagians liturgy. So, instead of, so you see, instead of G sharp, we've got G flat. In fact, in the original Comitas version, the whole thing is in A flat, not in A major. Sahagyans transposed it up a semitone. A major is a much nicer key for string players than A flat. So you see, it's the same modality. But it's not just Armenian, there are Byzantine hymns that also do this. In some Byzantine hymns, there's a sort of convention whereby you do di-da-da-di-da-dum. So you sharpen when you're going up and flatten when you're going down. And there are notational systems that also suggest that maybe singers in the past would neither completely sharpen nor completely flatten, but they would sing something in between. So there are all sorts of theories about this. But Hovhaness was, I think, influenced by this sort of modality when he composed. Now, next movement has magnificent harmonies also, incredible chords. It's for soprano solos, and then it's joined by a female semi-chorus. I'll just play you a little bit of the recording, if I may. Note that Hovhaness does clever things. This is not aleatoric. It doesn't have random elements, this movement, but you will find that the harp is playing all sorts of notes in various places at various moments where you don't expect. So it's as if, different bits of light, or various stars are shining or flashing at different places in the sky in an unexpected way. It's an effect that is difficult to describe in words, but it's best savored by listening. So I'll play you a little bit.
Yes.
Now, there's another soprano solo, a beautiful movement, and this has a modality which is not found in Armenian sacred music, or in most Armenian sacred music, as far as I know. It's clearly Oriental, but not, I think, Armenian. And it is in triple rhythm, and there's a sort of lilt to it. It's not quite a waltz, but it's almost like a waltz. I'll play you this, if I may. There's this almost hypnotic effect with the harp and the various pizzicati, like crackling snow. Marvelous, marvelous. Let's continue with the piece. Fecit potentiam is where the contralto has her solo. It's a magnificent movement, and it's like a very slow and stately sort of Greek dance, because the rhythm is, the meter is pom 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 pip 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 pom pom pom. So it's something like one and two and three and four and tim tum 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 pom pim pom pim pom pom pa 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 pip pip pa pa pip pip, but at a slower tempo. And here we enjoy the trombones at the beginning, and the harp also. I'll play it to you. That's the best thing.
Potentiam,
I said trombones. In fact, it's a solo trombone accompanied by the strings here. Magnificent movement. Now, we come to the senza misura passages. Those are at the very beginning, but here they're especially prominent. You can hear them. And Hovhaness himself has written the score, the senza misura passages are free rhythm, rapid collision passages in strings, which cannot be performed by one player on the piano. The pianist, if you're doing this with piano or organ accompaniment, must try to create a sound of confusion, mysterious, sometimes rising to a thunderous climax. And that is what we try to do with the strings of our orchestra. This movement is for the male semi-chorus and solo tenor. I'll let you hear a little of it. Magnificent harmonies there, you can hear the gentlemen's voices are forming. The next movement has a female semi-chorus, Sushepit Israel, Puerum Suum, and it's very interesting to notice. I find this very reminiscent of Bach, because in his own Magnificat, he writes this movement again for female voices. Sometimes they're sung by solo female voices. My preferred version is again with female semi-chorus. Let's hear the Hovhaness setting first of this movement. And notice the sounds made by the harp in odd places where you least expect them. Well, if you're conducting and you have the score in front of you, you do expect them, but as a listener, they're meant to surprise and make you smile. Now, Bach's version, which we sang at the Chapel of the Czech Brethren at Koruny Street in Vinohrady in Prague on the 10th of March 2018, I don't know why some people seem not to be smiling in this photograph. They look rather tired. I know we had a quick rehearsal and then we started performing. So, the Bach, this is in the Corboz recording, the same words, Bach's version, again female voices.
Thank you.
So you see the female voices, oboes, quite a lot in common. I can't prove it, but I do suspect that Bach proved an inspiration to Hovhaness, not only throughout his career, but particularly for this movement. Now, here, in the next movement, Sicut locutus est, we find that the sensa misura passages, which hitherto we heard in the strings, well, they appear also in the case of the chorus. They are divided into eight, and they all sing the same words, sicut locutus est ad patres nostros, they may start together, but they don't stay together, and they all sing something a little different. And I'll play you this so that you can hear the effect. After the two oboes, the two horns, the two oboes, you'll get a sensa misura passage on the strings that gets louder and then goes right down again, and then the choral voices. Now, it was exactly this kind of effect that worked so well in a place like St. Vitus's Cathedral, where there's a lot of echo and where the acoustics are very, very resonant indeed. It's less easy to make this work in a dry recording studio. You also heard the bass solo there. Excellent. So now let's proceed to the last movement, the Gloria. The composer has labeled it in the style of a noble galliard, which is a slow dance in triple rhythm. And it's a sort of duet, or rather a dialogue, between one trumpet and another trumpet antiphonally. One plays, the other one answers, and the other one answers back. And again, note the same modality. Magnificat anima mea dariri, and yadidadidadadadadadadam. So you see the E flat here, where I've marked it with an arrow, the same modality. You can see it a little earlier as well, when the trumpet plays. So it starts with the tenors and the sopranos and the tenors. Magnificent. And this then is connected to the final few words. Sic ut erat in principio et nunc et semper et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. In other words, in the ages of ages, for all eternity. Amen. And here also the same triadic harmonies and the changing meter. And da 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 di do 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 da 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 rom. So ya di do. Having heard the A natural, you hear the A flat, and so on and so forth. You heard the D flat there, but you hear the D natural there, and then another sensa misura trumpet, and then the following passage. Ya da 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 di. And then you hear the bell and the tom-tom, which is really a glorious effect. And usually you hear the bell, and during the second half of the next beat, you hear the tom-tom. And to have a big resonant tom-tom in St. Vitus's Cathedral is a wonderful experience. It's not so easy in Prague for a student orchestra to get hold of a decent bell. These are tubular bells. And, you know, the better the quality of the instrument, the better it sounds. So it's really worth it. In this recording, they had some good instruments available to them, of course. So I propose that we conclude by listening to the whole of the Gloria, which is the last movement of the Magnificat. So, ladies and gentlemen, this was what I wanted to say about the piece. So I'm profoundly grateful to so many people. My late music teacher, Mr. Hairabet Torosyan, who played this piece on the radio and then brought me a cassette of it at my request when I was still a child. His Excellency Ambassador Mr. Seyranyan and his wife, Nunez Astuchova, who were receptive to my proposal that we perform this piece in St. Vitus's Cathedral, and the embassy very kindly financed the piece, not least hiring those various instruments, extra musicians, but mostly hiring the music from the publishers, because the music is still in copyright. For which reason, it is quite possible that when I place this on YouTube, perhaps the musical illustrations will have disappeared. We shall see. If that happens, do please accept my apologies if you are listening to this on YouTube later on. And not least, I'm profoundly grateful to members of the Charles University Chorus and Orchestra, who trusted me and allowed me to teach them this music, music that I know and love very well, and made such an enormous success of it in St. Vitus's Cathedral on the 24th of April 2015. And above all, to Alan Hovhaness, who composed it and left us this magnificent legacy, no pun intended, magnificent Magnificat. But there are other pieces as well that are well worth doing and which maybe we should do before too long. So thank you very much indeed, ladies and gentlemen. I shall now stop recording and ask you to pose any questions that you might have, which I'll be happy to deal with, to answer in English or in Czech, as you might prefer. So I shall stop recording now. Thank you very much.